Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the DTE Studio online interactive class on basics of electrical and electronics engineering. In today's session, we are going to solve one question paper. So that's previous year question paper, November, December 2017. So end exam is for 100 marks and the duration is 3 hours. So this is the question paper. So in this, there are two part. In the part A, so out of 9 questions, we have to answer 6 questions. Each question carries 5 marks. In the part B, totally 10 questions are there. So out of which, we have to answer 7 full questions. Each question carries 10 marks. So in the part A, first question is, state any 5 effect of electric current with an example for each. So then you have to state the 5 effect and one example for the each. Each carries 1 marks. So for example, if you are mentioned as a heat effect, then you have to give 1 example as a electric iron or water heater, sound effect, headphone, buzzer and electric doorbell, light effect, fluorescent lamp, incandescent lamp, mercury paper lamp, mechanical effect, electric train and lift, magnetic effect, motors and electromagnetic relays, chemical effect, nuclear reaction and electroplating, cooling effect, air cooler and refrigerator. So out of which you have to answer 5, any 5 with 1 example. So each carries 1 mark. Second question, state Ohm's law and mention its units. Here the statement of Ohm's law carries 2 marks and 3 marks for the limitation. So totally 5 marks. So Ohm's law states that the current flowing through the conductor is directly proportional to the voltage applied to the ends of the conductor and inversely proportional to the resistance of the conductor, provided that the temperature is maintained constant. So mathematically, we relate I is proportional to V divided by R, where I is the current flowing through the conductor in amperes and V is the applied voltage in volts and R is the resistance in ohm. So we can write it as I is equal to V divided by R. Limitations of Ohm's law. It holds good only at constant temperature. It cannot be applied to electrolyte. It cannot be applied to semiconductor. It cannot be applied to vacuum tube and discharge lamps. It cannot be applied to complicated circuits having more number of branches and EMF source. So out of this 4-5 limitation, so you have to mention at least 3 of them. Define reluctance, magnetomotive force and mention the unit. So in this, the division is like this. The definition of each carries 2 marks and the unit carries half mass. So totally 2.5 mass for the reluctance and the 2.5 mass for the magnetomotive force. So 2.5 mass for the reluctance. So in the reluctance, you have to define as it is an opposition offered by the material to the creation of magnetic flux in a magnetic circuit. So the unit is ampere turn per Weber. R is equal to MMF divided by flux. MMF is nothing but N into I divided by phi. So the unit of MMF is ampere turn, unit of flux is Weber. So the unit is ampere turns per Weber. So either you have to write any one of the formula. So even if you are not written, it is no problem. So you have to define and write the unit. So if you are unable to define, so if you remember the formula, if you write this formula itself, then it will get some marks for that also. Magnetomotive force, MMF. Magnetomotive force is defined as the force which creates or tends to create magnetic flux in a magnetic circuit. So MMF is written as N into I. N is the number of turns and I is the current in ampere. So the unit of MMF is ampere turns. So the fourth question is, what is a transformer? Mention any three applications of transformer. So in this, the student has to define the transformer and three applications. Here I have stated seven applications, out of which three has to be written. Definition carries two marks, that is definition of transformer, two marks, and its application, three marks. One application for each. One mark for each application. The transformer is a static machine which transfers electrical energy from one circuit to another circuit, either at the same voltage or at the different voltage, but at the same frequency. So we know that transformer is a stationary device which transfers electrical energy from one part to another part, so another circuit. So the frequency has to maintain constant, but either there may be increase in the voltage or decrease in the voltage, or it may be an ideal. So you can define the transformer as a static machine which transfers electrical energy from one circuit to another circuit, either at the same voltage or at the different voltage, but at the same frequency. Applications of transformer. So step-up transformers are used in the generating station to step up the voltage. Step down power transformers are used in a receiving station to step down the voltage. Step down means that is to decrease the voltage. Step up means to increase the voltage. Distribution transformers are used to transfer power from one network to another. Isolation transformers are used to electrically isolate two circuits without changing voltage, current and frequency. So isolation transformers are also known as ideal transformers. So that is to isolate two different circuits. So higher power circuit from the lower power circuit. So power circuit and the control circuit are isolated by a isolation transformer. But here the voltage, current and the frequency remains same. Radio frequency transformers are used in communication circuits for tuning purpose, impedance matching circuit as a coupling device. So tuning circuit means that is to select a different frequency signals. So this transformer is used as a inductor in parallel with the capacitor to select different frequency range. Impedance matching circuit means, so the maximum power will be delivered only when the impedance of the load, that is antenna circuit load impedance, should be equal to the transmission line impedance. So then only the maximum signal will be delivered. So under that condition, the transformers are used as a matching impedance device. And is a coupling device to transfer power from one circuit to another circuit. It can be used as a coupler. So radio frequency transformer are used in communication circuits for tuning, impedance matching and as a coupling device. Small and miniature type transformers are used in voltage stabilizer, radio, SMPS and TVs. Small power transformers are low capacity are used in the voltage stabilizers, that is to maintain the voltage constant, radio stations, switch mode power supply and the television network. Auto transformers are used as a starter for a three-phase induction motor and as a booster to raise the voltage at the receiving end. State any five advantages of three-phase supply over single-phase supply. So fifth question. So you have to state any five advantages. Each advantages carries 1-1 mark. So you have to state five advantages. 5 into 1 total marks is 5 marks for the question. So I have stated 8, out of which you have to answer 5. The same size of three-phase alternator has more output capacity than a single-phase alternator. For a transmission of some amount of, say, amount of power, it's not some, it's the same amount of power, three-phase system requires less conductor material than the single-phase system. Sorry, it is not some, it is the same amount of power. For a transmission of same amount of power in a three-phase system requires less conductor, means less cable, than the single-phase system. In case of three-phase system, lighting and power circuit can draw from the same line. So, but in case of single-phase system, separate lines have to be drawn. So, in three-phase motors are self-started. So, while the single-phase motors are not self-started. So, for the same output capacity, three-phase motor is smaller in size than the single-phase motor. Three-phase motors have smooth torque, while the single-phase motor have pulsating torque. So, power factor efficiency of three-phase motor is better than that of a single-phase motor. Three-phase motors can build to a large capacity while the single-phase motor cannot. Sixth question, list out any five applications of DC motor. So in this, any five application has to be considered. So each application carries 1 mark. So DC shunt motor. DC shunt motors are used for lathe machine, centrifugal pumps, woodworking machine, blower and fan. So DC series motor are used in crane, hoist, electric trolley, conveyor, electric locomotives. DC compound motor. DC compound motors are used in rolling mills, shearing machine, punching machines, etc. So we all know that DC motor is a constant, DC shunt motor is a constant speed motor. So wherever the constant speed is required with a medium torque, the DC shunt motor is used. So the compound motor, where the high starting torque is required and the speed is increasing with the load. So under that condition, compound motors are preferred. So in the series motor, the speed is variable and the high starting torque. So wherever the high starting torque is required and the variable speed is required, then we prefer a DC series motor. Seventh question, what is a fuse? List the types of fuse. So definition of the fuse carries 2 marks and different types carries, listing of different types carries 3 marks. So fuse. Fuse is a simple protective device connected in series with the circuit to be protected. When excessive current flows, it melts and breaks the circuit and thus protects the equipment or circuit. So different types of fuses are rewirable fuse, cartridge fuse, high rupturing capacity, HRC fuse. So definition. At least 1 or 2 lines of definitions is required. So what is a fuse? Fuse is a protective device. What it does? It protects the circuit. How? It protects the circuit by when the excessive current flows through the circuit by melting and breaking the circuit. So that way, in that way, we have to define. Fuse is a simple protective device connected in series with the circuit to be protected. When excessive current flows, it melts and breaks the circuit and thus protects the equipment or circuit. Different types of fuses are rewirable fuse, cartridge fuse and high rupturing capacity HRC fuse. 8th one, distinguish between primary and the secondary cell. So any five differences you have to code. So each difference carries one mass. So 1 into 5, totally 5 masses for the question. So in the primary cell, the electrical energy is obtained as soon as the cells are assembled. So when the secondary cell, the electrical energy is obtained only after charging the cells. So in the primary cell, the chemical action is irreversible. So that is, in cells, it converts chemical energy to electrical energy. So whereas in the secondary cell, chemical action, that is conversion of electrical energy to chemical energy and chemical energy to electrical energy, is possible. So whereas in the primary cell, the energy is stored in the form of a chemical, so it is converted to electrical energy when it is connected to the circuit. So whereas in the secondary cell, the chemical action is reversible. So that is, during the charging, it converts electrical energy to chemical energy. During discharge, it converts chemical energy to electrical energy. So in the primary cell, no maintenance is required. So whereas in the secondary cell, frequent charging is required. That is, the maintenance is required. So once the cell is exhausted, it cannot be reused. Whereas the secondary cell can be reused. Efficiency of primary cell is low, where the efficiency of secondary cell is high. So the capacity is low. Here in the secondary cell, the capacity is high. So the examples are dry cell, zinc, chloride cell, mercury cell. So here in the secondary cell, nickel cadmium cell, nickel iron cell, and lead acid cells. So out of which you have to quote 5 differences. What is a diode? List any 3 types of diode. So what is a diode? Diode is a semiconductor device. So it is an uncontrolled semiconductor. Uncontrolled means the output cannot be controlled. Uncontrolled semiconductor device. A semiconductor device conducts only in one direction. So when it conducts only when the anode is at higher potential than the cathode. That is, when the diode is forward bias, it conducts. When it is reverse bias, it does not conduct. So a semiconductor diode has 2 terminals, namely anode and cathode. This is a symbolic representation of the diode. So diode is an uncontrolled semiconductor device. A semiconductor diode conducts only in one direction. A semiconductor diode has 2 terminals, that namely anode and cathode. This is a symbolic representation of the diode. So different types of diodes. So out of which you have to mention any 3 types. So PN junction diode, Zener diode, photodiode, PIN diode, Schottky diode, Schottky diode, step recovery diode, and tunnel diode are the few examples out of which you have to list. In the part B, you have 10 questions. So out of which you have to answer 7 questions. Each question carries 10 marks. Distinguish between the conductor and the insulator. So then at least you have to write 4 differences. This question carries 4 marks. So each difference carries 1 marks. So conductor, we all know that conductor is one which allows electric current to pass through it. So insulator does not allow electric current to pass through it. Conductivity is high. Here the conductivity is poor. So conductivity is high in the conductor, whereas in the insulator the conductivity is poor. It opposes the flow of current, means resistance is very high in the insulator. It allows the current in conductor, so resistance is less. So in the conductor, large number of free electrons are exist. So here no free electrons are exist. It is a positive temperature coefficient. So insulator is having a negative temperature coefficient. Positive temperature coefficient means the resistance increases with the increase in the temperature, whereas in the insulator, the resistance decreases with the increase in the current. So example, all the metals are the good conductor: copper, aluminium, silver and gold. Insulator, for example, wood, paper and rubber. So out of which you have to mention at least four differences. Three resistors of 6 ohm, 10 ohm and 20 ohm are connected in parallel across a voltage source of 100 volts supply. Calculate effective resistance, total current in the circuit, current through each branch. So write the circuit diagram. So three resistors, R1, R2, R3 are in parallel. So R1 equal to 6 ohm, R2 equal to 10 ohm and R3 is equal to 20 ohm and the supply voltage is 100 volts. So in this problem, so for calculating the effective resistance carries the 2 marks. So the total current, calculation of total current carries 1 mark. So current through each branch carries 3 marks. So I1, 1 mark, I2, 1 mark and I3, for I3 calculation, 1 mark. So write down the circuit. R1, R2 and R3, so they are connected across a supply. So supply is 100 volts. R1 is 6 ohm. R2 is 10 ohm. R3 is 20 ohm. So when the resistances are in parallel, so the equivalent resistance is calculated as reciprocal of the resistance, sum of the reciprocal of the resistance. Here there are three resistance, R1, 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. So R total or R equivalent is equal to 1 by 6 plus 1 by 10 plus 1 by 20. It turns out to be 0.32 ohm. So this is not an R equivalent, it is nothing but reciprocal of the R equivalent. So don't forget to take the reciprocal to find the R equivalent. So R equivalent is nothing but 0.32. 1 divided by 0.32, that's equal to 3.125 ohm. So this carries 2 marks. So writing a circuit diagram and the formula carries 1 mark, substituting the values and the final result has got 1 mark. Now find out the current. So current flowing in the circuit. So what is I? According to Ohm's law, current is equal to voltage divided by the resistance. So here the voltage is 100 and the resistance is 3.125. It turns out to be the main current is 32 ampere. So that main current is 32 ampere. So now find out the branch current I1, I2 and I3. So we know that in the parallel circuit, the voltage across each element is same. So the current is the sum of the individual current. So I1 is equal to V divided by R1. So because they are in parallel, the voltage remains the same. That is 100 divided by 6 gives you the I1 has 16.67 ampere. Similarly, find out I2. I2 is V divided by R2. So V is 100, R2 is 10. So 100 divided by 10 means 10 ampere. Similarly, I3 is equal to V divided by R3. 100 divided by 20. 5 ampere. Define, now the next question is, define electric power and electrical energy. Mention the meters used to measure them. So the electric power is defined as, electric power is defined as the rate of doing electrical work. Rate of doing electrical work is nothing but a electric power, or you can define it as a rate at which the electrical energy is expanded. So it is denoted by the letter P. So P is equal to V into I, or P is equal to I square R, or P is equal to V square by R. So the instrument used to measure the power is wattmeter. Is the instrument used to measure the electric power. So the unit of power is watt. So in the question they ask only to define and to mention the meter. So the unit of power is watt. It's not necessary to mention the unit, but in the question they ask only for mention the meters used to measure the measure them. So here we have to write watt meter. So you can write either any one of the definition as electric power is defined as the rate of doing electrical work, or rate at which the electrical energy is expanded. So you have to write one definition, at least one relation. So if this carries, the definition carries 1.5 marks, and the meter, so for the meter it carries 0.5 marks. So totally 2 marks for each. So electrical energy, so the definition of electrical energy again carries it 1.5 marks and 0.5 marks for the meter. So electrical energy is defined as the amount of electrical work done in a electric circuit, or electrical energy is said to be expended when certain amount of charges are transferred from one point to another point against a potential difference in an electric circuit. It is denoted by the letter E. E is equal to Q into V. Q is the charge in coulombs, V is the voltage in volts. Or Q can be related in terms of current and the time. Q is equal to I into T. If you substitute that, then E is equal to IT into V, or VIT. So E is equal to P into T, where P is nothing but the power. Power is equal to V into I. So the instrument used to measure the power, yes, wattmeter. The instrument used to measure energy is the energy meter. So in this, we have to define the definition of electric power carries 1.5 marks. The instrument to measure electric power carries 0.5 marks. And 1.5 marks for the definition of electrical energy, and for the instrument to measure electrical energy carries 0.5 marks, totally 4 marks for this question. Two bulbs of 100 ohm each connected in series across 230 volt supply, find the power taken and the energy consumed in the circuit if the current flows for 4 hours through a lamp. Here the calculation of power carries 3 marks, energy consumed carries 3 marks, so totally 6 marks for this question. So here two bulbs are connected in series. So when the resistances are series, the resistance are additive in nature. So the total resistance become R1 plus R2. So two resistances are in series. Instead of resistance, we have a bulb. So each bulb having a resistance of 100 ohm. So they are connected across a supply of 230 volts. 230 volts. So find the equivalent resistance or the total resistance. When they are in series, the current flowing through resistance is same. The voltage across each resistance is the sum of the voltage across each resistance is equal to the supply voltage. So, and the total resistance is equal to R1 plus R2. So, R1 is 100 ohm plus 100 ohm gives you the RT is equal to 200 ohm. Then the power. So, calculate the power. So, we know voltage. Voltage is 230 volts. Voltage is 230 volts. So, now write the relation between power in terms of voltage and the resistance. So that is V square divided by R. So what is V square? 230 square divided by R is 200. It works out to be 264.5 watts. Okay. So write the relation of energy. So the energy, we know resistance, voltage and the power. So power into time gives you the energy. So power is 264.5 into time. So the lamps are on for a duration of 4 hours into 4. So that gives you 1058 watt hour. So the unit of energy is watt hour, the unit of power is watts. Explain the construction of DC generator. This carries 6 marks. So the diagram and the labeling carries 3 marks and the explanation carries 3 marks. So in the diagram you have to mention the main parts, that is armature, pole, commutator segment, yoke and the central shaft. DC generator consists of following parts: yoke, pole, armature, commutator, brushes and bearings. Yoke, it is an outermost covering for a DC generator. It protects from moisture, dust, dirt and fumes, etc. and provides a mechanical support to the pole. The yoke is made of materials which provides low reluctance like cast iron. For the large machines, cast steel, silicon steel or royal steel is used. Pole. Pole consists of pole core and pole shoes. Pole core carries the field winding to produce flux. The pole core is enlarged to produce a necessary flux under the armature area. The pole is made of magnetic material like cast iron, cast steel, and it is made of lamination to reduce losses. The field windings are made of good conductor like copper or aluminium. Armature. The armature consists of armature core and armature winding. So the armature core consists of slots on the periphery to carry the armature conductor and as duct for airflow for the cooling purpose. Armature core is made of cast iron or cast steel. It is made of lamination to reduce the losses. Armature winding consists of armature conductor placed in the armature slots. The EMF is induced in them by cutting the magnetic flux set by the pole. Armature conductors are made of aluminium or copper. Commutator is a cylindrical in shape and is made of segments. Each segment is insulated by mica insulator. The commutator is made of copper material. Commutator collects the current from the armature conductor. The conductor commutator converts AC to DC. Brushes collects the current from the commutator. They are made of soft material like carbon to avoid wear and tear of commutator. Bearings. Ball bearings are usually used, but for a heavy machine, roller bearings are used. So here I highlighted some points with the blue color. So that is related to the working. So it's not necessary to mention these points in the construction. Even if you mention, no problem. So here one thing you have to remember. So for the field, it should be made up of a cast iron or cast steel or rugged steel for a bigger machine. So whereas the windings are made up of field winding or armature winding made up of copper or aluminium. Field windings are placed in the field slots and the armature windings are placed in the armature slots. So the commutator is made up of copper of good conductor. That different types of material and different parts that you have to explain. Next question. Distinguish between statically induced EMF and dynamically induced EMF. So here you have to quote at least four difference. So each carries one mass. So totally four mass for this question. Statically induced EMF. The EMF induced in the coil due to the change in the flux linking with it without any movement of coil or field. Statically means a stationary. Here both coil as well as the field remains stationary. So the change in flux is achieved by changing the current flowing through it to the coil. So whereas in the dynamically induced EMF, so anyone, that is either the magnetic field or the conductor, has to move. So in the dynamically induced EMF, the EMF induced in a conductor due to the relative motion between a magnetic field and a conductor. So in case of statically induced EMF, it has a coil or the field remains stationary. Here the conductor or coil rotates or field has to rotate. So there are two types, self-induced EMF and mutually induced EMF. Here there is no type. So example, for statically induced EMF, transformer. Dynamically induced EMF, AC and DC generator. Draw the sine wave and mark the following. Peak value, one cycle, time period, positive instantaneous value. So for this, you have to draw the waveform. Drawing a sine waveform, sine wave diagram carries two marks and marking each carries four marks. So one mark for each. So amplitude is the maximum value you can observe. So this is the Vmax amplitude. So that is the maximum value or the peak value or amplitude. So time period means one complete set of positive and the negative set of values. This is the one cycle. Time period. So the time taken to complete one cycle. Positive instantaneous value. Instantaneous value means the value of a quantity, either voltage or current at any instant. So during the positive instant of cycle, you mark an instantaneous value. So this is a positive instantaneous value. This is a positive instantaneous value. So for marking, each carries four marks and the drawing the sine wave carries the two marks. So totally six marks for this. An alternating current I is given by I is equal to 141.4 sine of 314. Find frequency and time period. So the frequency calculation carries two mass and the time period calculation carries two mass. So totally four mass for this question. Yeah, I is given by I is given by 141.4 sine of 314 t. So the standard equation I is equal to I max sine omega t. So compare these two. So you get I maximum, maximum value of current is equal to 141.4 amperes. So what is omega? So omega is nothing but angular frequency. So that is equal to 314. So we all know that omega is equal to 2 pi f. So to find out frequency, frequency is equal to omega divided by 2 pi. Okay. So omega is 314 divided by 2 pi. So gives you the frequency as 50. So frequency, the unit of frequency is hertz or cycles per second. So you know that relation between the frequency and the time. So t is equal to 1 divided by f. So that is 1 divided by 50 or seconds, or if you shift this, 20 milliseconds. So time is equal to 20 milliseconds or 0.02 seconds, and frequency is equal to 50 hertz. So calculation of frequency carries 2 marks and the time period carries 2 marks. So writing an equation carries 1 marks, substitution and the final answer carries 1 mark each. Explain the construction of AC generator. So in this you have to write a diagram. So in this diagram should indicate the main parts, that is the pole, armature, rotor and stator, and the windings, yoke, you have to mention. Any related diagram you can write. So brief explanation is required. So drawing a diagram carries 3 marks, diagram and labeling carries 3 marks, and the explanation carries 2 marks. So totally 5 marks for the question. An alternator consists of 2 structures, rotor and the stator. So stator is a stationary part. It is used for holding the armature winding or stator winding. The stator core is made of lamination of silicon steel alloy or magnetic iron to minimize the eddy current losses. The rotor is cylindrical structure having a large number of poles fixed on its outer rim as shown in figure. So these are made of silicon lamination. The field poles are placed on the rotor. A DC source which supply to rotor windings through a DC rotor windings is called as an exciter. So this is fed from a small DC generator mounted on the shaft of the alternator. So the DC supply is given to the rotor winding through the slip rings and the brushes arrangement, and the field structure rotates. Next, 14th question. An AC circuit consists of 30 ohm resistance and an inductive reactance of 19 ohm connected in series across 200 volts supply, 50 hertz, 200 volts, 50 hertz supply. Find impedance, current and power factor. So list out the factors given. So here it is a problem on AC circuit. So what are the factors given? Resistance, that is 30 ohm, impedance XL, that is 19 ohm. We have to, reactance 19 ohm, we have to calculate impedance, current and the power factor. So in this, calculation of impedance carries 2 marks, calculation of current carries 2 marks, and the power factor carries 1 mark. So totally 5 marks for this question. Write on the circuit. So resistance in series with a inductor. So across a AC supply. So AC supply is 200 volts and 50 hertz. Resistance is 30 ohm. Reactance is 19 ohm. So R is equal to 30 ohm. Reactance XL is equal to 19 ohm. So we have to calculate impedance, current and the power factor. Current and the power factor. So impedance is given by in AC circuit the total opposition, that is the vectorial sum of resistance and the reactance. R square plus XL square. So here directly they are given the inductance. In case if you have given the coil inductance L, then we have to calculate XL is equal to 2 pi FL. So F is the frequency, L is the inductance in Henry. So but here in this problem they are directly given the XL. Substituting this, so it will be 30 square plus 19 square under square root is found to be 35.5 ohm. So now find out the current. So the current is nothing but voltage divided by the impedance. So the voltage is 200 ohm divided by 35.5. So gives you the 5.63 ampere. So for this, we have an impedance triangle. So this is the XL and R along the x-axis. The resultant is the Z. So the angle between this is the phi. This is XL. So what is cos phi? Cos phi is nothing but adjacent side divided by hypotenuse, R divided by Z. Right? So here, what is R? R is 30, Z is 35.5. So that is equal to 0.85. So here it is an inductive circuit, so it's a lagging power factor. So if it is a capacitive circuit, then the power factor is leading power factor. If the circuit comprises of both inductor and the capacitor, so whichever is greater, either inductor or the capacitor, depending on the value. If it is inductor greater, then it is a lagging power factor. If the capacitor is having a greater reactance, then it is a leading power factor. But here it is an inductor and the resistance, so it's a lagging power factor. So in this calculation of impedance carries 2 marks. So that is writing a formula carries 1 mark and substitution of the values carries 1 mark. The current calculation carries 2 marks. So the 1 mark for the formula and 1 mark for the substitution and the final answer. And the power factor carries 1 mark. Half marks for the formula and the half marks for the final answer. What is FHP motor? List any 3 types of FHP motor. FHP means fractional HP, fractional horsepower motor. So FHP motor is an electrical motor with a rated output power less than 1 HP. So the motor HP is less than 1 HP, then it is termed as a FHP, fractional HP motor. So or otherwise 736. We know that 1 HP is equal to 736 watts. So different types of FHP motor. So you have to write at least any three FHP motor. Single phase motors like split phase motor, split pole motor, universal motor, and the special motors like stepper motor, servo motor, and brushless DC motor. So out of which you have to mention at least any three types. So here definition carries 2 marks and the different types carries 3 marks. So totally 5 marks for this question. State the application of single phase AC motor. So here the question is for 5 marks. So each application carries 1 mark. So totally you have to mention 5 applications. Table fan, ceiling fan, air dryer, mixer, grinder, pump motors, refrigerator, vacuum cleaner, and washing machine are the applications of single phase motor. So observe, all these are the domestic applications. List different types of enclosures. So here we have to mention at least 5 types. So each type carries 1 mark. So here the question is list, means we have to write the different types. No need to explain them. So open type, dip proof light type, totally enclosed natural air cool type, totally enclosed fan cool type, wash down, and flame proof type. These are the different types of enclosures. That is the outer covering of a machine. State the advantages of 3-phase motor over a single phase motor. So the question is for 5 marks. For each advantages, 1 mark. Totally you have to write at least 5. So 5 into 1. So 5 marks for the question. So the advantages are the output of 3-phase motor is more than that of the single phase motor of same size. The 3-phase motors are built for large capacity. The 3-phase motor produces high and smooth torque without any pulsation. The efficiency and the power factor is higher in 3-phase motor than in the single phase motor. 3-phase motors are cheaper than the single phase motor of same capacity and rating. 3-phase motors have higher power factor. 3-phase motors are self-started. Explain the necessity of protective devices. List any 3 types of protective devices. So here the necessity carries 3 marks and the different types carries 3 marks. So necessity of protective devices. 3 marks means at least we have to write in 3 points. To protect the equipment from the fault due to high current, high voltage, overheating, and firing. So to protect the equipment from voltage fluctuation, it may cause partial or permanent damage to the equipment. So to protect the operator from the insulation failure, it may cause shock to the operator. The atmospheric lightning strokes can cause fire and damage to the building. So to protect the device from all these drawbacks, it is necessary to have a protective device. Different types of protective devices are fuse, MCB, ELCB, earthing, and relay. MCB means miniature circuit breaker, earth leakage circuit breaker. So out of which you have to mention at least 3 protective devices. State any 4 general safety precautions. So here I have listed 8, out of which you have to mention at least 4. So 1 mark for each. So 4 into 1, totally 4 marks for this. General safety precaution to prevent electrical accident. Disconnect the power supply before repairing any equipment. Always use the tool with insulated handles. Never use metallic pencils or key punches to remove the nuts and bolts. Wear leather shoes and hand gloves. Do not bring the equipment in contact with water or chemical. If there is a fire, do not throw water on it. Throw sand to extinguish the fire. Discharge the capacitor before using it. The socket should be fixed at a height beyond the reach of children. As per electrical rules, the socket should be fixed at an height of 1.5 meters from the ground. So if you are using a capacitor, then the capacitor should be completely discharged. If there is a fire, don't throw the water, because the water is a good conductor. So to extinguish the fire, you have to throw sand. So do not bring water or chemical in contact with the equipment. So always use a leather shoe and gloves for repair work. So because they provide an insulation. So never use the instruments or tools without insulated handles. So before repairing, disconnect the power supply. So these are the safety precautions, out of which you have to mention at least 4 precautions. So this question carries 4 marks. Explain p-type and n-type semiconductor. N-type semiconductor. The intrinsic semiconductor, like germanium atom, has 4 valence electrons. When a small amount of pentavalent impurity, like arsenic, is added to the germanium, large number of free electrons are available. 4 valence electrons of an arsenic atom forms the covalent bond with the 4 valence electrons of germanium atom. The 5th valence electron of arsenic atom find no place in the covalent bond, and thus it is free, as shown in figure. So thus n-type semiconductors are formed. So the intrinsic semiconductor means it is a pure semiconductor. So to increase the conductivity, we have to add the doping elements, like a pentavalent impurity or trivalent impurity. When the pentavalent impurity is added, penta means 5. So in the 5 valence electron, so valence electrons are nothing but the electrons in the outermost shell. Okay. So when pentavalent impurity is added, so it has 5 valence electrons. So germanium is already having a 4 valence electron at the outermost shell. So the 4 electrons of germanium is binded with the 4 electrons of arsenic and forms the covalent bond. So one more electron of arsenic is left over. So it has no place in the covalent bond. It left as shown in the figure. So that it means that there is a one excess of electron. So in the n-type material, there is an excess of electron, or deficit of holes. So the majority carriers of n-type is electrons, and the minority carriers are holes, or the positive charges. P-type semiconductor. The intrinsic semiconductor, like germanium atom, has a 4 valence electron. When a small amount of trivalent impurity, like gallium, is added to the germanium, large number of holes are available. The 3 valence electrons of the germanium atom forms the covalent bond with the 3 valence electrons of the germanium atom. So the 4th valence electron of the germanium atom finds no electron of the gallium atom to form the covalent bond. So thus the hole is created in the covalent bond, as shown in the figure. So thus p-type semiconductor is formed. So intrinsic semiconductor means it's a pure semiconductor. So like silicon and germanium. So they are having a 4 valence electron. So when the trivalent impurity, tri means 3. So 3 valence electrons are there in the trivalent impurity. For example, gallium is added. So the 3 valence of gallium and the 3 valence electrons of germanium forms the covalent bond. So but the one more electron of germanium doesn't find an electron. So it is left. Sorry. it is left. It means it makes a creates a hole. So it has a deficit of electron or excess of positive charge or holes. So in the p-type semiconductor, majority charge carriers are holes and the minority charge carriers are electrons. So when the pentavalent impurity is added, n-type is formed. When the trivalent is added, p-type semiconductors are formed. So for this, so you are going to have explanation carries 2 marks for the p-type and for the n-type 2 marks. So totally 4 marks for this. With a neat circuit diagram and the waveform, explain the working of half-wave rectifier. So writing a circuit diagram carries 2 marks, waveform 1 mark, and the working 3 marks. Totally 6 marks. So this is a circuit diagram, transformer, diode, and the load circuit. It consists of a step-down transformer, single diode, and a load circuit RL. So operation. So during the positive off cycle of the AC supply, the point A is positive with respect to point B. Means point A is at higher potential than the point B. Under this condition, what happens? The diode anode is connected to point A, means the anode is at higher potential than the cathode. So this makes the diode D as a forward bias. So when it is forward bias, when the supply voltage is greater than the breakover voltage, then the diode conducts. It behaves like a closed switch and current flows through this. Okay. So observe, this is a supply voltage waveform during the positive off cycle. So there is an output because the diode acts as a closed switch. During the positive off cycle of the AC input voltage, point A is positive with respect to point B and the diode D is forward bias and it conducts. Hence the current flows through it, the supply voltage appears across the load RL. So what happens during the negative off cycle? So during the negative off cycle, the point B is at lower potential. Point B is at higher potential than the point A. So the reverse of the positive off cycle. So point A is at lower potential means the anode of the diode is connected to the lower potential. The cathode is connected to the higher potential. It means that the diode is reverse bias. So when it is reverse bias, it behaves like an open switch. So when the circuit is open means there is no power available at the load circuit. During the negative off cycle of the input AC voltage, the point A is negative with respect to point B and the diode D is reverse bias and hence it does not conduct. That is, there is no flow of current. Hence, there is no voltage drop across load RL. Hence, diode conducts only during the positive off cycle of the AC voltage. So hence it is known as a half-wave rectifier. It conducts only during the positive off cycle. During negative off cycle, it behaves like an open switch. So the output voltage is zero. Draw the logic symbol and write the truth table for the following gates: NOT gate, OR gate, and NAND gate. So logic gate symbol of each carries 3 marks. Truth table carries 3 marks, totally 6 marks. So this is the logic symbol of NOT gate. X is the input and Y is the output. So the output is equal to X bar, complement of the input. Here the no explanation is required. So you have to write the logic symbol and the truth table. So truth table means the output for all the combinations of the input. So when the input is 1, the output is 0. When the input is 0, the output is 1. So NOT gate is the only gate having single input and all the gates are having single output. So NOT gate is the only gate having a single input line. OR gate. So this is the symbol of OR gate. A and B is the input and Y, X is the output. It performs the logical addition operation. So X is equal to A plus B. So different combination of the input, that is A and B, the corresponding output is shown in the truth table. So when it is 0, 0, the output is 0. When it is 0, 1, the output is 1. When it is 1, 0, the output is 1. When it is 1, 1, the output is 1. Or so 1, or you can write it as high or logic high level, or logic 1 on true are the different combinations. 0 logic low level, false and off are the different combinations for the logic low level. NAND gate. So NAND gate performs the logical multiplication and the inversion. So it is the combination of the AND gate and the NOT gate. So AND gate is given by A into B, multiplication operation. NOT gate is the inversion. So X is equal to A dot B whole bar. So the truth table is like this. When it is 0, 0, the output is high. So when it is 0, 1, the output is high. When it is 1, 0, it is 1. When it is 1, 1, the output is 0. What is a BJT? List different types of BJT. So the definition of BJT carries 2 marks and the types carries 2 marks. So BJT means bipolar junction transistor. It has 3 terminal. 2 junction semiconductor device. Here it's a controlled semiconductor. You can control, that is we can turn on or off the device by controlling the base current. So the 3 terminals are namely base, emitter and the collector. So the bipolar junction transistors are further classified into NPN transistor and the PNP transistor. So when the P-type material is sandwiched between the N-type to N-type material, then the transistor formed is NPN transistor. Similarly, when the N-type material is sandwiched between the 2 P-type material, then the transistor formed is PNP transistor. So this is the layer diagram and the symbolic representation of NPN and the PNP type of transistor. So the definition carries 2 marks and the types carries 2 marks. Totally 4 marks for this question. Thank you for patience listening. If you have any questions, you can ask.